Hi, I'm Ron Major, Senior Scientist at Agilent Technologies, and I'm here with John Henderson, an LC Application Specialist. We're going to take you through the steps to transfer a reverse phase HPLC method currently performed on a 5-micron conventional porous particle column to a new 2.7-micron superficially porous Poroshell 120 column. Poroshell 120 columns are made by Agilent using a proprietary process that ensures they have very similar selectivity to existing phases, so method transfer is easy and flexible. We're working today with the Agilent 1200 rapid resolution LC system, an instrument that has pressure limits of 600 bar. But it's important to note that the great results can be achieved using the Poroshell 120 on any HPLC system, even those with a 400 bar limit. And also on the 1290 Infinity UHPLC system, which has a 1200 bar limit. Just keep in mind that the Poroshell 120 column can only be used at pressures up to 600 bar.
You know, Ron, there's a lot of enhanced features on newer instruments that can increase sensitivity and performance. However, the reality is some labs won't be upgrading all their instruments right away.
That's right, John. It's important to understand that you'll be able to use the tips we provide here today even with older instruments like the Series 1100 or any 400 bar conventional HPLC instrument. Let's take a look at the new superficially porous particle columns. Most of you are familiar with the sub 2-micron porous particles, which can give efficiencies of nearly 250,000 plates per meter. These are different. Poroshell 120 columns have particles that are 2.7 micron outer diameter, but these are superficially porous particles. That is, they have a solid core and a porous shell. Now, because of faster diffusion into and out of the porous shell and a very homogeneous packed bed, these columns provide analytical performance that's comparable to a sub 2-micron particle, but at the pressure of only a 2.7 micron particle, and that's usually less than 400 bar. Today, we're working with Poroshell 120EC for NCAP C18, a USP L1 designated phase. This C18 particle is end-capped with a small silane reagent to cut down on silanol interactions with polar compounds. We look at how we can dramatically increase the speed of a naproxen tablet analysis while preserving our chromatographic resolution. Naproxen is a very popular non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug and somewhat polar. Because of their high efficiency, very narrow peaks elute from Poroshell 120 columns. And they elute rather quickly.
You'll find typically Poroshell 120 peak volumes are 50 to 75% lower compared to totally porous 5 and 3.5 micron columns of similar size. The most relevant system parameters for optimization of these smaller peak volumes are detector response time, connecting tubing volume, and flow cell volume. Demonstrating these system parameters in optimized and de-optimized system configuration will emphasize the results.
First, let's look at the chromatogram we're getting from our current method. This USP method requires efficiency of more than 4,000 plates and resolution better than 11.5. In our original method shown here, we are using a Zorbax Eclipse Plus C18 column with the dimensions of 4.6 by 150 millimeter. It's packed with 5-micron particles. Note that the separation on naproxen and the internal standard butyrophenone is accomplished in just under 8 minutes. At a flow rate of 1.2 mils per minute, the back pressure here was 100 bar. Next, we're going to look at the analysis with a Poroshell 120 column. Its dimensions is 4.6 by 100, just slightly shorter than the other column. Here, we've saved 4 minutes in our analysis, cutting the time in half.
Look at the back pressure, Ron. It's only 238 bar.
That's really a low back pressure for HPLC, isn't it?
It is. It's only 3,500 PSI.
However, you can even go faster with this analysis. Looking at the next chromatogram, we've changed to a 50 millimeter column, half the length, and still have a flow rate of 1.2 mils a minute. Compared to our initial 5-micron column, we've reduced the analysis by a factor of 4.5 when we use the very short column.
And the efficiency is closer to the original method on this shorter column, with still plenty of resolution.
Yes, and it's very easy to get these results. There are just a few things you should be aware of to get these optimum results. We're going to walk you through the steps we took to transfer this method to the Poroshell 120 column. John?
First, we want to optimize our data collection rate in the detector. You optimize detector settings by adjusting the scan rate and/or the time constant to the fastest possible settings so that the signal to noise is not adversely affected. The peak width, as defined in the ChemStation software, is the width of the peak at half height. With the Poroshell 120 column, expect narrow peaks, similar to those generated with sub-2 micron columns. Set the detector to the fastest setting, then to the second fastest setting, and evaluate if the signal-to-noise levels are different. Try to avoid using faster response time than you need, since this may lend to greater noise in the baseline.
On screen, I'm going to show you a series of chromatograms that illustrate the effect of a change in the data collection rate. If it's too slow, as you'll see along the bottom, the peaks will be artificially broadened. Even if you have the right column, your data won't look very good. See that at the top, when we get to the 40 Hz and the 80 Hz chromatograms, look how much better our results are. Next, let's look at a table which shows us the same information, but in a slightly different manner. Here we see a comparison of the efficiencies of Poroshell 120 with different data collection rates. As you can see, we've highlighted the line at 40 Hz, which provides the sweet spot for our column. For 2.1 millimeter ID columns, the column volumes are even smaller, but the effective data collection rate is still the same. Okay, we've set the data collection rate, now what?
You need to think about flow cell selection. You want to choose the flow cell carefully. Smaller volume flow cells, such as the semi-micro or with a 5 microliter, or micro with a 2 microliter volume, are recommended for best performance.
Of course, the smaller the volume of the flow cell, the shorter the path length, which may decrease sensitivity for a UV method.
Good point, Ron. The column diameter plays a major role in the flow cell choice. Now, to change out your flow cell, here's what you do. When you put the flow cell in, you want to make sure it clicks into place. Hook up the waistline with the finger tight fitting. And tighten that up.
Thanks, John. That was pretty simple. Flow cells are an integral part of an HPLC system. The tendency is to use a longer flow cell in order to more easily detect the compounds of interest. However, they can also be a source of extra column volume, so a compromise must be reached, as is typical in most chromatography situations. Note the falloff in efficiency as the volume of the flow cell increases, especially noticeable for the 2.1 millimeter ID column. For example, you'll see a 30% loss in efficiency with a standard 10 millimeter flow cell. So with 2.1 millimeter columns, it is best to use a 3 millimeter flow cell. Larger flow cells used at fast data collection speeds can be used with larger volume columns as shown here for this 3.0 by 100 millimeter Poroshell 120 EC-C18 column. A 3 millimeter ID column has 2.25 the volume of a 2 millimeter column of the same length.